start now with Audrey De Jong. Audrey, thank you for your first presentation on the pre-oxygenation.
Thank you for the invitation. Airway management is very challenging in hypoxemic patients. In this picture, you can see the rate of complications according to the setting of intubation, intensive care unit or operative room, the obesity status of the patient, and the difficulty of intubation. The higher rate of complication of intubation is when the intubation is difficult, performed in an obese, critically ill, hypoxemic patient. The ultimate complication associated with intubation procedure is cardiac arrest. Cardiac arrest is more frequent in case of intubation of an hypoxemic patient compared to an intubation performed in planned surgery. In this ICU cohort, the rate of cardiac arrest related to intubation was 2.7%. One of the main risk factors of cardiac arrest related to intubation was if the patient was hypoxemic before intubation and if the pre-oxygenation was not performed. That's why optimizing pre-oxygenation in the management of hypoxemic patients is very important. Non-invasive ventilation is the method of pre-oxygenation who has proved superiority over standard oxygen, the reference method of pre-oxygenation, to limit the decrease of desaturation during intubation procedure. If high-flow nasal oxygen has failed to prove superiority over standard oxygen to increase the lower saturation during intubation procedure, it could be very useful to continue administration of oxygen after removal of the mask for pre-oxygenation and allows apneic oxygenation. That's why combining non-invasive ventilation, the best method of pre-oxygenation in hypoxemic patients, with high-flow nasal oxygen has been found to reduce desaturation during intubation procedure compared to non-invasive ventilation alone. Combining the two methods could be the best method of pre-oxygenation in patients with high risk of desaturation. After optimization of pre-oxygenation, intubation has to be performed. Specific score predicting difficult intubation has been developed and validated in the ICU patient. There were factors related to intubation, Malampati score 3 or 4, obstructive apnea syndrome, reduced cervical mobility, limited mouth opening, less than 3 centimeters, but also factors related to pathology, as coma or severe hypoxemia, and factors related to the operator with low experience in the operative room. In case of predicted or unpredicted difficult intubation, the use of video laryngoscope could be very useful to increase glottis visualization and decrease the rate of difficult intubation. Two categories of video laryngoscope exist. The first one is the video laryngoscope with a standard shaped Macintosh blade, which allows to see the glottis either directly or indirectly via a screen. When the glottis is seen indirectly, the glottis visualization is improved from 1 Cormac score. The other category of difficult intubation device, video laryngoscope, is when a specific blade of difficult intubation, very angulated, is placed. This specific blade allows to increase the Cormac score from 2 points. Thank you.
Thank you, Audrey, for this first and very clear presentation. Now we have time to discuss your presentation, and I will ask to my colleague if they had some question or suggestion to Audrey about this first part.
Maybe one question, Audrey. Do you think that finally video laryngoscope will become the standard of care in the next few years? Or no?
Yes, absolutely. I think now, especially the device which allow to perform the two forms of laryngoscopy, direct laryngoscopy, but also indirect laryngoscopy, are very appropriated for all the airway management in operative room. So all the intubation could be performed with this device.
And do you think also that this will become the standard in the ICU? Or finally, are ICU patients very different from operating room patients?
I think that the operators have to be trained to airway management and to the use of video laryngoscope. So if the operators in ICU never use the device, it could be not a good device. But if the operators are trained, I think at least 20 to 30 intubation performed with the device video laryngoscope, it could be also the standard of care in ICU.
It's very important message. You say that we need to perform at least 20,
yes,
or 30 procedures to become.
It depends on the study. It's 20 to 60, even in some studies, to be very efficient with video laryngoscope, because of the angulated blade, it is not the same movement than with direct laryngoscopy.
That means, Emmanuel, some randomized clinical trial published in very severe patients, both in operating room and in critical care area. We have some negative study using the video laryngoscope, and you mean that probably one of the explanation of this negative trials could be the absence of operator expertise, probably this is the case, that is your message, and if you could not
yes.
use it, if you don't have a learning curve around, you said 20, 13, at least?
Yes, at least.
This is a very important message for the future. That means we should be cautious about the interpretation of the negative study. This is your message, Emmanuel.
Yeah, and I fully agree. I think we need to replicate these studies, because yes. negative results could be obviously explained by not enough experience of the... of the physician who perform intubations.
Yes, absolutely.
François, maybe you have some suggestions?
Yes, only one question regarding the pre-oxygenation procedure. So you mentioned that the combination of high flow and non-invasive ventilation will give the best pre-oxygenation in the most hypoxemic patient. But in the real life, it is possible to combine high flow and non-invasive ventilation in case of emergency procedure?
Yes, it is possible. You need a two oxygen device, and then you use high flow with one of the oxygen device, and the other is connected to the ventilator, and you can pre-oxygenate with the facial mask, the usual facial mask, connected to the ventilator, set in non-invasive ventilation mode. Then with the high flow device, you put the nasal cannula below the mask, the standard pre-oxygenation with the non-invasive ventilation mask, and then when we removed the mask, we can intubate it and then switch the ventilator to the mechanical ventilation mode.
We have one question coming from some internaut that one of our anesthesiologist colleagues said, probably anesthesiologist, we are late, because he said that nobody could imagine that a gastroenterologist making his endoscopy with his eye directly on the tube. But he thinks that today we are probably late, because maybe more than 20 or 30 years before we should use this device. What do you think about this? He's right?
Yes, I totally agree with this man, yes.
Thank you. Do you have, Audrey, some side effects about the different strategy that you propose, making that the positive pressure, like CPAP, like non-invasive ventilation using pressure support ventilation and PEEP, or the combination of both, non-invasive ventilation or high-flow oxygen therapy? Do you have some reports about side effects like inhalation, like pneumopathy? Do you have some incidence or prevalence or some message for the anesthesiologist?
No, I think it can be performed in case of emergency and in case of even in case of full stomach.
Yes.
Because the pressure applied are very low and are not enough to have any adverse effects related to risk of inhalation.
Could you have a value of positive pressure that we should never exceed it? Because to be safe, probably we should be at the low level pressure, positive pressure, that to avoid the inhalation, avoid the esophageal gastro reflux.
Mm, yes.
Do you have some advice of safety?
Yes. The sum of positive and expiratory pressure and pressure support has to not exceed 15 centimeters of water, or the most it's 20 centimeters of water. But I think 5 of PEEP and 5 of expiratory support is enough to enhance the oxygenation. No, no high level are needed.
This is clear. You have comment about this, I think, Emmanuel, in operating room. Sometimes we could exceed this value, you think?
Yes, I think yes. So we have a lot of device that allows to improve this very critical period that is the pre-oxygenation period in the surgical patients. And clearly we have to improve our the way we perform the pre-oxygenation. It's exactly the same finally in the operating room and in the ICU, and this kind of device can obviously be very interested, yeah.
It's very clear, okay. The main message of this presentation is first to increase the oxygen reserve of the patient, and mainly in the hypoxemic patient in case of oxygen desaturation, and to avoid complication. Okay, thank you very much. I think that